morning and welcome to Bethel Temple. I'm Pastor Devin, and we are so excited that you joined us today. If you've joined us for the past few weeks, or maybe this is your first time today, I invite you to do three things. First, please fill out a connection card located at the bottom of the seat in front of you. You can drop this in the offering receptacle on your way out, bring it to the hub, or scan the QR code for an online form. Secondly, please come to Growth Track. This is a great opportunity for you to find out what we believe and how to get involved here at Bethel Temple. And lastly, join a connection group. Connection groups meet in homes across our community and fellowship around food and devotions. This is a great opportunity for you to build relationships with people who are working out their faith just like you. These three things help us to get connected to you and help us to get you plugged in. Once again, we are very excited that you joined us today. Service will start in 30 seconds.
Y'all stand with us and just get ready to worship. Hey, good morning, everyone. Hope everyone's having a great morning. Let's get ready to worship.
Silence is the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and claim your victory. Let it rise. Giants fall, fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Let faith be the song that overcomes the raging sea. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it rise. Let faith arise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. We cannot survive when we praise you. The God of strength is on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God be praised.
place, and we thank you that your word declares, God, that when we lift up our praise, that your glory comes down. God, we thank you this morning that you inhabit the praises of your people. And as we enter into this time of worship, we just pray, Lord God, that all we do and say would bring glory and honor to you. God, lead us, guide us, and direct us this morning as we have gathered in this place to lift up the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Be enthroned on our praise. In Jesus' name, we all agreed and said, amen. Your praise continually be on our lips as we offer a sacrifice of praise to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the one who's worthy of it all. When all I see is a battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you you see a mountain move
as I walk.
And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you.
Come on, sing this now. When I fight,
so when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my
this morning that you have gone before us, that you've made the crooked way straight, or that you have gone before and prepared the way. And Lord, that every need that we have, Lord, that in you the answer is already there. Father, we thank you that we can turn our eyes to you, that we can look to the hills from where our help comes. And Lord, that you are the author, the finisher, and the perfecter of our faith. And again, God, as we begin to offer a song of praise to you, that your glory comes down, encamps, and dwells about us. You've been down long enough. No more walking in shame. Cause the way that he loves you isn't something you can change. You've been running in circles, but you can't hide from grace. Cause the way that he loves you isn't something you can change. Just like Lazarus
out of that grave, our God rewrites history.
Jesus, you change everything when you pour your spirit out. Just like Silas singing with Paul, praise can break down prison walls. Jesus, you can have it all. Won't you pour your spirit out? Pour your spirit out. Pour your spirit out. Now listen. You can rest in his presence. You can trust in his name. Cause his burden is easy. And he's perfect in his. You can run to the Father. There's no reason to wait. Cause his arms have been open. And that's not something you can change. Yes. Just like that.
Roll back that stone. let's put the last words up there. Well, that would work too, but let's do that last verse. How about Paul and Silas? Go to the next verse. Okay. Anybody remember that story? I pointed out earlier this morning, but I want you to think about this. If you don't know the story of Paul and Silas, at this venture here, they're in prison. They're not just in prison, they're in the inner parts of the prison. They're in the dungeon. And they're not there because they're a hardened criminal. Listen, I'm a firm believer. You do the crime, you do the time. Four of you believe that. We're going to get the rest of you. They weren't there because they were hardened criminal. They weren't there because they had done something wrong. They were there because of their faith. And if you look at their story, it seemed like for them, when Saul became Paul, it seemed like one thing after another happened. Shipwreck, beaten, thrown in prison, I mean, just multiple times, bit by a snake. And anybody that goes through hard times knows that when you're in the deep, dark dungeons of life, you sit there and you lament how bad and unfair life is. But that's not what they did. See, they took a play out of God's playbook, and in the midst of adversity, in the midst of things that were going wrong, rather than sit there and lament how bad life was and how unfair life was, what'd they do? They had a worship party. They begin to lift up the name of Jesus. They begin to have a worship setting in the middle parts of that prison. I used to tell people that God knew two of Elvis Presley's songs long before he ever lived. See, they got together, began to sing and worship, and they got all shook up. The jailhouse rocked, and they got set free. And that's a lesson for us, that when we go through tough times, ours is not to sit there and lament how unfair and how bad life is. It's in the midst of the difficult things that we can't do anything about that we lift up an anthem of praise, because it's in the midst of that praise that he comes down. Amen. That's what the Bible teaches. I preached a message years ago, when the praises go up, the glory comes down. And that's as true today as it's ever been. And maybe you're here, and I want to thank you for being with us online this morning. Maybe you sit wherever you may be tuned in this morning or watching, and maybe you're in the midst of a chaos. Maybe you're in the deep, dark valleys of life. And the temptation is to sit there and think about how unfair life is. I want to tell you, do the opposite. Do the opposite. Rather than fuss and moan and groan and complain, just go ahead and sing a hallelujah anyhow. And just go ahead and declare the goodness of the Lord anyhow. Because you know what it's like to walk in here with the mully grubs. But when you start worshiping, something changes. The atmosphere changes. Your outlook changes. Why? Because he's come and he lives by that. I want us to go to the Lord in prayer this morning. How many of us today have a need that you would signify by lifting your hand? Pastor, I've got a need in my life today. I need God to do something about it. Listen, I believe in answered prayer. I believe that God is more than enough to answer our prayers. I want us to pray especially for our children. Some of them have already started school. Some will be starting school. Let's pray for our teachers. Again, I mentioned this in the early service, but you need to understand that our children are in the crosshairs of the enemy. The Bible says he walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Through culture and pop culture and all these other nuances that are in our culture today, he's targeted our children. And we want to pray as they go back to school that God would protect their minds, their spirit, protect them physically, that God would watch over them, our school campuses. Listen, all the stuff that you see on TV with the mass shootings and schools and things like that, that is evil at its base level. It is the brokenness of our world that allows that to happen, and only he can change that. Not enough police officers, not enough legislative action can change the heart of man. Only him And that's what we pray for. Let's join together today. Father, thank you. Thank you that you roll back the stone. Lord, that stone means death. It means the end of hope. It means just chaos. But Lord, there's a miracle right behind the stone. Lord, because you're calling to those things that appear to be dead, those dreams, those hopes, those relationships. Lord, you're calling life to those things that seemingly are dead. And you're calling to them and bringing life to them. Father, I pray this morning for every hand that went up in the building this morning, those that have tuned in. Lord, you know what our need is. And I thank you that you are big enough to meet the need. Lord, you're more than able. That's what Paul said. Now, unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or imagine. Lord, we thank you that there's no sickness, no disease that you're not able to heal. Lord, I pray that you'll extend that healing hand today and touch those that are infirm today. Touch those that are in pain, even right now while we sing, while we're here. That arthritis pain, that fibromyalgia, Lord, that neuropathy in the feet. Lord, just touch, bring healing. Lord, thank you that you're bigger than cancer and leukemia. Lord, glaucoma. Lord, thank you that you're bigger than all of those things. Respiratory infections, they have to bow to you. COVID-19 has to bow to you. It all has to go because you're our healer. I pray, Father, for those that are struggling with emotions. Lord, I pray that you would uphold us with your powerful right hand and that you would give us joy that is unspeakable and full of glory. Meet that financial need that is so desperately needed today, that unexpected expense that came. Lord, I pray that you will meet that need. Father, I pray, Lord, we stand in agreement right now with our children and our grandchildren, those our littles that go back to school this week, some that have already started. Lord, we pray your hand of protection upon them. Protect them physically. Protect them emotionally. Protect them spiritually. Lord, as they go out, Lord, know that the weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. Lord, we cover them with our prayers. We cover our schools. We cover our teachers, our staff, administrators, Lord. Let your light shine through them. And Lord, I pray, let revival take place on the campuses of our schools. Lord, let it start with the young ones. And Father, we pray for revival in our land. Lord, we now lift all of these things up to you today, believing that we receive what we ask for, because we ask it in faith. And in Jesus' powerful name, we all agree together, and everyone said, amen. 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 Give the Lord another hand clap of praise this morning as you're seated today. Amen. Amen. God bless you so much. Amen. Thank you. How many love Jesus? Amen. How many love your neighbor? Amen. How many love your seatmate? Amen. Well, that got less right there, I'm telling you. Some of you sitting in the wrong spot. Now, we're so glad that you're here today. We're going to get right into our word this morning. A couple things that just, again, thank you for your faithfulness. We were on Wednesday. We went out. We had a group Cook Elementary School, and we served. We cleaned. We fixed things. We moved things. We tore things up. I like that. So we tore things up. We put things together. We had a great day. We printed things and copied things and folded things, and it was a great day serving our local school. Thursday, we did our food distribution. We served over 200 families. And none of this could happen without your faithfulness in serving and in giving. So thank you for that. We continue to serve our community. We love serving our community. If you're new to our church family, that is who we are. We like to serve. We like to do things. We like to be Jesus with skin on. And we look for every opportunity that we can do that. So, again, thank you for that. This morning, and the backpacks, if you came in this morning, you saw backpacks. We had some left over from last week's giveaway, and so we've got folks and kids that will be getting backpacks again today. We had well over 100 backpacks that were loaded with school supplies and enabled them to be able to go back to school. And again, that couldn't happen without your faithfulness. So thank you for doing that. What a great honor it is to pastor and serve here in Cleburne, Texas, Johnson County. We have people from all over the county, and we are a county church. We believe in impacting Johnson County and beyond. Let's go ahead and turn to our word this morning. We're going to get right into it. And Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. We are in our series. Last week I took a break simply because we were doing our backpack giveaway. So I took a break. But today we're going to resume that. We have a couple more messages in this series. And the series is dealing with hot topic issues that are relevant to where we are today. So we're going to dive right in. I want to pray before we get started this morning. This morning I'll be dealing with the LGBTQ and homosexuality. There's probably very few hot button issues that rile people like this one here. And so I want to pray that we have clarity of thought and understanding. Again, I'll talk about that here in a minute, but let's just pray together. Father, right now we come to this time where your word is to be declared. And so, Father, we pray that, Lord, unashamedly, that your word will be spoken, Lord, with clarity, Lord, that it would be received with clarity, would be understood, that your truth is what sets people free. Well, I pray for every design of the enemy that is designed against this message and against what the content of your word says. I pray, God, that you would, Lord, we resist him in your name. And Father, we pray that you would just allow the free flow of your information and your truth. And I pray, God, that you would give receptive hearts and the order or in the intent in which it was given. I pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen. Revelation. Romans chapter 1, beginning verse number 24. Very familiar passage for most people. I actually taught through the first 8 chapters of Romans on our Wednesday night teaching. It's been a couple years ago. But let's look at verse 24. It says, therefore God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men, committing what is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error, which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting. May the Lord add his blessing to his word this morning. Now again, as we get back into this is very difficult. If you know anything about me, I love people. I love serving people. I have never discriminated against anybody. I'm not transphobic. I'm not homophobic. I'm not, the only phobic I am is claustrophobic. And maybe Auburn phobic as we get into football season. But beyond that, I'm not scared of much of anything. I don't have phobias in that regard. So this message, again, we've been talking about hot topics for hot times, and we've tackled some very, how many have really paid attention? We've tackled some really relevant subjects that are very paramount to our day today. We talked about the authority of Scripture. And what does that mean? It means simply this: if I don't view God's Word as God's Word, if I don't view it as the ultimate source of what is right and wrong, then it doesn't matter what I believe on these other topics. And that's why early on I said that's why you have Christians today that can hold to liberal ideologies, liberal thought, and be okay with it, even though it contradicts Scripture, is because they don't see the Bible as the ultimate authority. I do. The Bible says, the psalmist says, forever, O Lord, your word is established. It's not being improved. It's not being added to. Forever, O Lord, your word is established. So I believe that the word of God is established. He said what he meant what he said. From there, we talked about abortion. We talked about racism. And we talked about transgenderism. Today, again, we're going to be talking about LGBTQ and homosexuality. And again, I'm just going to preface it by saying what I've said every single sermon. These messages are not based in hate and in anger. I'm not mad at anybody. I don't hate anybody. It's in my extended family, some of these deviant lifestyles. There is no angst within me whatsoever when it comes to these messages. However, as a pastor, it is my responsibility to preach the whole counsel and give the clear teachings of God's Word. And so, listen to me. As Christians, you and I are not free to pick and choose what scriptures we want to believe and those that we don't. God's word is not like, everybody know what a smorgasbord is? Or a buffet? That's the word I like. Paul said that. No, he said buffeted, but I say buffeted. God's word is not like a buffet line. You know, when you go to Luby's, you walk down the line and you got, I mean, how many ever have overload of, you know, sensory overload when you walk down the line at Luby's? I mean, you can get fried chicken, you can get fish, you can get ham, you can get all kinds of things. And so you're there, you know, if your eyes are bigger, and you get to select what you want. When I was in the military, I had one of the funny stories. I was Air Force, but I was stationed, I was a detachment to the Army. So my first time going and experiencing an Army chow hall, I walk in there. Now, I'm used to, through my training, I was on Air Force Base, and it's like Luby's. You walk into an Air Force chow hall, and you go down the line and say, I'll take this, and I'll take this, and I'll take this, and you do all that, and you go sit down and eat. So I go to the same mentality. I go to the Army chow hall, and I walk down the line. I say, I'll take some macaroni and cheese, and I'll take some mashed potatoes. He said, can't have it. I'm like, what do you mean I can't have it? You already got a starch on there. Move down the line. That was my first experience. And anyway. But you can't do that with Scripture. You can't pick and choose what you want to believe and what you don't want to believe. God's word is the ultimate arbiter between what is right and what is wrong. And that's where we start. Again, our children, you have to understand, our children today are being inundated with messages that directly contradict God's word. And I know as parents, it's very difficult to, how do you wade through all the stuff that our children, it's in our TV, it's in movies, it's everywhere you turn. Our society is saturated with deviant lifestyles that run contradictory to God's word. How do we combat that? How do we raise our children? I read a book one time that said, how to raise a G-rated kid in an X-rated world. And that really is the question for most parents. How do we do that? Our children are being inundated with these messages that run contrary to God's word. So, and this is especially true when it comes to the area of sexuality. Messages of purity are a thing of the past. We don't hear people talk about purity. There was a campaign many years ago called, anybody ever heard of True Love Waits? You know, there was a campaign that circulated the country. Actually, it was a worldwide campaign about True Love Waits. Today, if someone says sex before marriage is wrong, they're looked at like something fell on their head and they got brain damage. It's also true when it comes to same-sex attraction and homosexuality. You know, there are a few hot-button issues, as I've said, that rile people like homosexuality. If you say it is a sin, you are quickly eviscerated, and then you hear the statement, but love wins. And God wants us to love. That's what matters. Or they might say something like this, well, you Christians, that's all you talk about. That's the only sin that you ever mention or deal with. Well, the thing is, that's not true. I'm an equal opportunity offender. Sin is sin. Doesn't matter what label it is. Amen? Right? I am talking about homosexuality, but there are other sins. We recognize that, and I think we understand that. But that's an excuse. Well, you only talk about it. No, we don't. We talk about other things. Sin is sin. Again, just because we may talk about it and maybe not talk about the others quite as much doesn't excuse the sinfulness of that sin. It's not an excuse. Again, there's no other sin. You think about it. There is no other sin right now on the planet that has a PR firm behind it. You think about Hollywood. You think about athletes. You think about the media. You think about the government, they're all pushing this homosexual agenda down our throats. You can't turn on a television show without seeing it. You can't watch a movie without seeing it. It's everywhere. And again, so that's why it's highlighted, is because it's in your face blatantly everywhere. And our kids are seeing this. Again, you think back to 2015 when the Supreme Court ruled that same-sex marriage was a constitutional right. I said from this pulpit that the door was going to be open and that everything that you can possibly imagine will come flooding out of the door in 2015. Guess what? We're seeing that become a reality before our eyes. It has gained momentum and it is rolling over every other freedom in our society. You know, here's the thing. It's no longer enough. You think about where we are. It's no longer enough just to tolerate homosexual relationships. We are now being told to affirm and approve these relationships. Approve and affirm. Today, if you question the morality of homosexuality, you are labeled as hateful and intolerant, and then you are shamed into silence. I mean, think about how many people that were prominent in the media world, that were conservatives, people that had podcasts and people that had talk shows, radio and TV talk shows, that have come out on the side of biblical morality, they are no longer around. Because when you start tackling this hot button issue, people get very militant about it, and they take it to you, and you are labeled as all kinds of things, shamed into silence. Now, again, here's the thing. Don't read between the lines. There's nothing there. I am in no way condoning treating another human being ill. One thing that just grinds my gears as a Christian is to see other Christians standing up as though they're better than anybody else, beating them and berating them because of their sin. It just grinds me, because that's not what we're called to do. Love does win, right? It does win. Again, so again, we're to treat our fellow man as those who have been created by God, made in His image with purpose and destiny. Again, that's who God called us to be. Again, as Christians, we should never treat another person rudely or improperly, because Christ calls each of us to love our neighbor as ourselves, and He's not speaking of geographical neighbors. He's talking about people who aren't like us. We've got to love them with the love of Christ. But with that said, however, we should never diminish what God's Word declares, because it is upsetting and uncomfortable. How many's ever sat in a service and heard a message that unsettled you, that made you uncomfortable? Anybody ever sat in a service like that? That's called conviction, by the way. And conviction is to elicit a response. If you have condemnation, that's not of God. Listen to me, it's not of God. The Word of God is not about condemning, it's about convicting. Convicting leads to repentance. Repentance leads to freedom. Condemnation leads to bondage. What the enemy does, he wants to shame us, to get us to back down and to live in that guilt and that shame. But there's freedom in conviction. So just because something is unsettling and upsets us doesn't mean that we shouldn't talk about it or we shouldn't address it. Listen, we live in a world that we've raised a bunch of pansies, that anything that upsets their senses is to be avoided. Not so. Not so. Again, I can only imagine John the Baptist standing in our nation today, thundering against what he sees in our culture today. Listen, sin is sin. I understand there are more sin. I understand that there are sins that we have, that we talk about. But listen, sin is an affront against God. Plain and simple. Homosexuality, adultery, fornication, it's an affront against God. It's not an excuse. And we should never make light of it, because Jesus died in our place to settle the debt of sin. It should never be made fun of. And today you turn on sitcoms and they're laughing about adulterous relationships. They're talking about fornication and they're making fun of it and they're jokes. That's not a laughing matter, because it sent Jesus to the cross, because there was no other way for salvation. Listen to me. Homosexuality is a sin for which Christ died, and He wants to set people free. It is a sin that He died for, and He wants to set people free. Now, again, I am very vulnerable right now. I know I run the risk of ticking some folks off, but I need to stand here and tell the truth of God's Word. Our kids need to know and be grounded in God's truth, and I want to equip you to be able to have the difficult conversations with our children. Listen, the LGBTQ community has been very good at twisting Scripture to fit their lifestyle. I saw a video a few months back of a man who purported to be a preacher, and he had a Bible in his hand, and he was talking about the story of Jesus when he went to his friend's funeral, Lazarus. We sang it. And when Jesus stands in front of that tomb and he said, "Roll away the stone," remember what Jesus did? He said, "Come out. Come out." And it was in that rhema word that he spoke that the man had the ability, death had to let go of its grasp, and the man came out bound in clothes. And what this guy did was he took that scripture and said, what Jesus was saying is, come out of the closet. So they're very good at twisting scriptures to fit their lifestyle. Listen, if the Bible is God's Word, and I believe it is, and if it's the ultimate authority in our lives, then what we need to do is find out, what does God say about it? Because you know what? We could start over here with Danelle and go all the way around over here to Terry, and everybody has an opinion, right? They're like trash cans. Everybody has one. It's not our opinion that matters. It's His word that matters. That's it. It's the ultimate arbiter of what is right and wrong. So we have to look at what does God's word say about homosexuality? Well, I mean, He has weighed in on it, by the way. In fact, in every single age, God has opposed homosexuality. He opposed it during the time of the patriarchs. He opposed it in the law of Moses. He opposed it in the prophets. And He opposed it in the New Testament. Every single age, God has stood against homosexuality. Why? Well, God condemns homosexuality because it attempts to overturn God's design for humanity. What is God's design for humanity? In the beginning, God created male and female. And then He goes on and He says, "And for this cause shall a man leave his parents and cleave unto his wife, and the two shall be one." Homosexuality seeks to overturn God's design for mankind. So He opposes it. Listen, I said this in transgender, when I preached on transgender, your biology is a calling from God, not a social construct. I am a male because God made me a male. I love being a man. Where are my guys at? I love being a man. Again, you know, I said it before. I can get off the phone in 30 seconds flat. I'm good. I love being a man. If I see a man with the same outfit, we're going to become lifelong friends. I love being a man. But you know what? To the ladies here, God called you to be a lady. Your calling, divine calling of God, is to be a female. And so we're going to kind of explore this. See, today mankind has corrupted the Word of God, particularly relating to sexuality, because according to John chapter 3, verse 19, men loved darkness rather than the light because their deeds were evil. And today we like darkness because our deeds are evil. So in our text, let me just get right into this real fast. I ran out of time in early service, but there's a lot of stuff. In our text this morning, Paul is writing to the Romans, and what he's doing, the context of chapter 1, is he's showing the end result of when man decides to live by man's rules. The Bible says it's not within a man to determine his path. In other words, you and I are not smart enough to lay out our own course. We don't know the beginning from the end. We don't know. We don't know what tomorrow holds. So the Bible says it's not within a man to determine his steps. So Paul is saying, here's what happens when a man decides man rule over God rule. And so he goes through chapter 1 talking about what happens. And if you notice, you can read this later, but Paul in chapter 1 says, God gave them over three times. God gave them over three times. See, when men suppress the truth of God as revealed in creation and continue in that rebellion, Paul said that God's wrath is revealed from heaven, verse number 18. Again, this is not a very easy message to preach, because we, in our culture today, we want to hear that if you make Jesus Christ Lord and Savior, you'll never have another bad day. You'll never have to struggle with this. That's just not true. And we just want to hear messages about God's love and God's blessings, and we don't want to hear about the wrath of God. But Paul said, when you consistently rebel against God, suppress the truth of God, His wrath is revealed from heaven against these types of people. When God has had enough of sin and rebellion, how many parents have looked at your children and said, "I've just about had enough"? Some of you did that this morning. I just about had enough. Well, see, and again, I don't mean to imply that God is impetuous or fickle or anything like that, but there comes a point where God says, "Okay, I'm done. You keep insisting and insisting and insisting and insisting, and I've told you over and over again, it won't give you the joy. It won't do what you think it will do. But you know what? I'll take my hands off." When God's had enough of sin and rebellion, he withdraws His hand, and here's what He does. He allows the consequences of our actions to come full bear. And if you haven't noticed, that hasn't gone so well. It hasn't gone so well. So Paul outlines his judgment. This is what I'm going to talk about the rest of the service. He outlines God's judgment. It begins, number one, with sexual immorality. It begins there. Again, the first step away from God is sexual immorality. It's what happens when a society decides to turn away from God. Verse 24 begins with the word therefore. How many know that every time you see therefore in the Bible, you got to go back and find out what it's there for? Okay, so the therefore is pointing back to verses 21 through 23. And in there, he's talking about, he said, first of all, men become indifferent to the truth, and then their thinking becomes confused. And once their thinking gets off and it's confusing, then their hearts are darkened, and they can no longer distinguish between right and wrong. They think they can live without God, and they finally turn to idolatry. He said, that's the process. We start thinking, well, it's like Eve. The Bible says she saw the fruit and said, hey, looks good. Pleasing to the sight. Had the desire to make her wise. Good for food. In her mind, she said that. God said, don't touch it. Or don't eat from that tree. See, that's where the battle comes in right there. We see it. We think. So Paul picks up on that, and he goes on. Idolatry moves into immorality. Verse 24 says, therefore, God gave them over. I love this version. It says, God gave them over in their sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. Idolatry always leads to immorality. Once men make gods of their own making, okay, then we can rewrite the rules of human conduct. One of the Ten Commandments says, two of them actually, don't have any other God before me, and don't take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Now, a lot of people think that means swearing. Listen, I think Christians ought to have clean mouths, okay? But that's not really what that means. What it means is don't misrepresent God. So when you and I create God, a God as we fashion with our hands, then we're free to write the rules of conduct. And what may be right for Justin down here is not right. May not be right for me. I get the freedom to choose what's right for me, and he gets the freedom to. But that's not what the Bible teaches. Forever, O Lord, your word has been established. It's interesting to note that sex is singled out as the first step away from God. You know why that is? It's because sex is closely related to the human spirit. It's closely related to the human spirit. The way we conduct ourselves sexually is a good barometer of what's happening on the inside of our hearts. Sexual immorality seeks to fulfill a void by any means possible. And we know it doesn't work. Immorality never satisfies because it always involves deception. Verse 25 says, they exchanged, everybody say exchanged. They exchanged the truth of God for the lie, and they worshiped and served the created things instead of the Creator who is forever praised. Amen. Now think about that. When people turn away from God, the Bible says they exchange. What does that mean? It means they swap. They swap God's truth for the lie. So I know what you're thinking. You say, okay, Pastor, so what's the lie? Okay, well, here's the lie. The lie is that we can ignore God and still find fulfillment in life. That's the lie. The lie is that you and I can set our own course, that we can chart our own destiny, that we can make up our own rules as we go. That is the lie. We exchange God's truth for the lie. The lie is that we can break God's laws and still be happy, that we can live the good life without God. That's the lie, and that's what we do. We exchange God's truth that says it all depends on this vertical relationship for the lie that says I can be self-sustaining and self-fulfilled. And that's the lie. And haven't we bought into that in today's culture? See, God allows the unchecked sexual immorality to pervade a culture as a means of showing the futility of life without Him. See, that's what He's doing right there. God says, look, I'm telling you, it's not going to work. I know you think that an extramarital fling is going to help you out and you're going to find peace. I've actually heard people say that it stimulates my own relationship with my wife. Bonehead. I've heard that. That it keeps the spice in our marriage if there's an extra fling. And so we concoct all kinds of weird and bizarre things to justify our behavior. And we say, God, I know you said not to do this, but I'm going to do it anyway. And God's up there like, no, don't. I'm telling you, don't do that. Don't do that. I know the beginning from the end. I know the end result of this. Don't do that. You know, and we say, God, I'm going to do it anyway. So what does God do? God abandons. He gives way, He gives over people to sexual immorality. He lets them indulge their fantasies. He stands back while we rush headlong on this off the cliff of unbridled lust to the broken, jattered rocks of disobedience. Why? Because He wants us to know in the end, we're going to discover that life without Him is no life at all. Hey, when I was raised in church, I'm third generation, but when I became a teenager, I totally rebelled against everything I... was taught to believe, and I bought into this ideology here. And so I started indulging in life's pleasures because that's what I was told I needed. You know where it got me? To the bottom. To the bottom, I found out real quick that life without Him is really no life at all. Broken, messed up, in a barracks in San Antonio, Texas in 1985, I said, God, if you still need me, if you still love me, if you still want me, here I am. Here I am. Best decision I've ever made in my life. Listen, I understand. He wants us to get to the, He'll let us get to the bottom so that we know that we need Him. The second thing is, so the first step in God's judgment is sexual immorality. The second one is this, open homosexuality. It shouldn't surprise any of us that immorality always leads to homosexuality. By itself, listen, sex can never satisfy man. Can never satisfy man. Mankind. In other words, feeding the flesh is never ending. How many's figured that out yet? You can't just have one piece of pie. You want more pie. Lay's bought into that years ago when they had their commercial. Anybody remember the Lay's commercial? You can't eat just one. It creates an appetite. It's an insatiable appetite. That's what sex does. Sex can never satisfy. It never can fill the void. And so feeding the flesh, never, it's a never-ending thing. It promises more than it delivers. And so what happens is the mind conceives different perversions, pushing the limits constantly. Eventually, the desire crosses into the line of homosexuality. It's like the gateway drug. You know, they say there are certain gateway drugs, and if you succumb to those, then it only leads to something harder and harder and harder until you're a lifelong addict. That's the same thing with sexual immorality. It pushes the limits. No longer do you get your satisfaction from your own husband or your own wife. Now you've got to look outside the bonds of matrimony. And then after a while, that doesn't lead. And then all of a sudden, it crosses the line into homosexuality and even worse. Because it never does. It never satisfies. And God allows this as judgment on humanity. David Wilkerson said years ago that we're living Romans 1 right now. God took His hands off and said, you know what? You've insisted on your own way since the 60s. You have told me how you are sexually free and sexually promiscuous. And I'm just going to let you go. Go right ahead. And we're reaping the results of that. I mean, you know that homosexuality is not a new phenomenon. It has been around for a long time. In fact, ancient Greece and Rome were hotbeds of homosexuality. Some of the most famous philosophers of the day were homosexuals. Many of the political leaders of Rome were, in fact, the first 14 of the 15 Roman emperors were homosexual. It's just been something that's been going on for a long time. Whenever men turn away from God, terrible things begin to happen in society. All of a sudden, these long-held standards are discarded. Evil doesn't seem evil anymore. The basic distinctions between male and female are obliterated. No one can tell the difference between right and wrong. We say, what's your right is not my right, and what's your wrong is not my wrong. And that's where we are in our culture today. We're doing that which is right in man's own sight. Here's what happens in that atmosphere. Homosexuality is first tolerated, and then it is accepted, then it is praised, and finally it's enshrined as the ultimate freedom. And we're at that place now. Every vestige of society is pushing this agenda, and our children need to understand the battle that's around. Mom and Dad, you don't bury your head in the sand. I promise you, your children are being exposed to this doctrine more than you would even care to admit. Be on guard. Be their sentinel. Let me give you three things relating to homosexuality. Number one, homosexuality is a willful choice, not a biological imperative. I want you to think about that. I understand that we live in a broken world, okay? And I understand there are probably people that struggle with same-sex attraction because of the brokenness of our world. But it is a willful choice, not a biological imperative. God did not make us that way. That contradicts Scripture. Everything the Bible has to say about homosexuality begins with that one fact. It is a choice. It is a learned behavior. It is a chosen path, a personal lifestyle decision. Notice what Paul said. God gave them over to shameful lust. God gave them over to it. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, men also abandoned natural relationships with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with one another and received in themselves the due penalty for their perversion. It is an exchange, Paul says, a swapping of what is natural for what is not natural. Again, that's not my words. Already this morning, we I preached the early service, already had a message this morning that said, hey, I was looking for a church, but you people hate people. And I thought, you have no idea who this church is. Again, you run the risk when you start saying stuff like this, you run the risk, of people jumping on that bandwagon and talking about God's love. But again, it doesn't change God's truth. It doesn't change His truth. Again, it is a willful abandonment of what is natural for that which is unnatural. Not only is homosexuality a willful choice, it is one that completely reverses the natural order of creation. Men and women must directly suppress the way God made them to practice homosexuality. I had a young man one time ask me about it. And again, we've had people from the homosexual community that have attended our church, many for several years, and I've loved on them and cared for them just like I would anybody else. I have no discrimination in my body whatsoever. But I've always stayed true to God's word. I've always stayed true to it. And this young man asked me about what I thought about it. And I said, well, here's the thing. And I don't mean to come across crude the way it's going to sound. But I said, I'm a heterosexual male. And I said, you know what that means? I said, it means I like women. And I said, the more women, the more I like it. And I know it sounds crude, but I was just being very transparent with him. I said, my nature is to be with every woman that I see. That's the base nature. That's who God created. Again, that's who He created us as male and female. I have an attraction to female. I said, but here's the thing. When I accepted Christ as my personal Lord and Savior, I had a new nature. And that new nature now is I'm going to live by His word and by His rules and not my own. And that new nature says that I'm committed in a relationship with my wife, and I'm to be faithful to her, okay? And secondly, the Bible says that sex outside of marriage is sinful. So I said, I can't. So I have to die daily to the natural desire to be with women. I said, if you have a same-sex attraction, then the same power that enables me to suppress and crucify the natural tendency to be with every woman is the same power that will cause you to be able to suppress your natural drawing to same-sex. It's no different. If you call yourself a Christian, you live by His standard, not your standard. Again, we have to in order to live this lifestyle, you have to suppress the truth of God. Homosexuality is a terrible sin, degrading, indecent, perverted, evil, and wrong. Anybody who argues otherwise is either ignorant of what the Bible teaches or they perverted its teachings. So, number two, widespread homosexuality is a specific sign of a godless society. This is undoubtedly Paul's main point in our context this morning. As a society moves away from God, again, you see sexual immorality that crosses into homosexuality. Again, that's what you see when we move away from God. Guess where America is today? We have moved away from God. The tragic fact is that's where we are today. And I don't say it as a veteran and a patriot. I hate to see where our country is right now. I hate to see the things that we're tolerating today and allowing today and promoting today and celebrating today. It bothers me. It bothers me that if you hold to Judeo-Christian values and you hold to biblical morality, you are shamed. I remember not long ago, there was a Major League Baseball player that during Pride Month, I guess, whatever Pride Month is, there was a baseball player that their club was going to wear a particular uniform to celebrate gay pride. And he said, I'm not going to wear that. He said, I can't. My Christian conviction does not allow me to support for this. He was vilified tremendously. Everybody came out of the woodwork eviscerating this guy because he stood on his biblical values. And I thought, you know what? I wonder if we could start a Jesus month, a celebrate Jesus month, and have all the baseball players and football players wear a cross, sing Amazing Grace at the ball games. I wonder if we could tolerate that. Probably not. Again, the tragic fact is that we're there on every front. On every front, we're being told that homosexuality is good, it is right, and it is normal. And those who oppose it are called homophobic. Listen, and for too long, our churches have been silent. We've not equipped. One of the things that Paul said that ministry is to do is to equip saints for the work of ministry. One of the things that we've not done is equip people to do the works of the ministry. One of those things is to stand and shine in darkness. We've held our peace with these issues while the and there's been a militant side. Not everybody, I don't mean that to imply that, but there's a militant faction within the LGBTQ community that have taken the battle to the streets. They will get in your face. They will picket you. They will march around your house. They'll do all this kind of stuff. And they're winning city after city after city after city. Listen, we have to speak God's truth in love and teach our children His truth regarding sexuality. Again, this is why I'm preaching this message. It is a call to parents and grandparents to teach a biblical purity to your children and your grandchildren and to model that. And to be able to explain to them when they see these types of things. Romans 1 is coming true right before our very eyes. America is under the judgment of God because we have turned away from God and we see it because of the homosexuality. We've said, you know what, we want to be free. We want to be open. We want to be tolerant and diverse. And God says, you know what, then go right ahead. Go right ahead. But here's the thing. You can be free to do whatever you want to do, but you'll have to face the consequences of your own decisions. See, that's the thing. We're free to choose, but we're also free to bear the responsibility of the choices. See, I am a product of where I am today, not because of somebody else. I can't blame society. It's my choice. I am here today by a correlation of the choices that I've made that have led me to this point. That's just the truth. God says, you can have it. You can be free to do all of that stuff. But you're not going to be free from the consequences. In fact, that's how Paul, guys, come on back as I wrap this up. That's why Paul said in verse 27, he said that homosexuality receive in themselves, notice what he said in verse 27, the due penalty of their perversion. It is a self-punishing sin. Think about this. One of the highest rates of suicide in our nation today is in people who struggle with transgenderism, LGBTQ leanings. It is a self-punishing sin. And it's not, and it would be easy for, and the media loves to jump on this, and they love to blame and say, well, it's the Christians that are condemning them. No, there are some knotheads that take the Word of God, and in fact, there's an internet preacher that made a lot of noise getting yelling and calling the homosexual community, all kinds of names. Listen, I don't think Jesus is pleased with that nonsense. Not at all. Don't bring it here. It's not what we're here to do. Stuart Briscoe said this. He said, when sexuality is misunderstood, the sheer power of unrestrained sexual drive and uneducated sexual insight will produce, notice what he said, will produce all manner of aberrant sexual behavior. He goes on. He says, in short, confusion about God breeds confusion about man, which breeds confusion about sexuality, which produces sexual confusion and chaos. He goes on, far from being what was fondly imagined by many, an enlightened age of sexual freedom, Paul showed his contemporaries that they lived in a dark day of divine wrath. That is the day in which you and I live right now. It's our world. We're living in a dark day of divine wrath. What you see unfold on the news every night, it is God's wrath that has been unleashed because He took His hands off. Here's the third thing, and I want to close with this. This message, I know if you're watching or you're sitting here, listen, it's in my family, my extended family. So, I don't have a bone to pick with anybody. I don't hate anybody. I just soon have a whole section of people that are coming out of that lifestyle. Would to God that that would be so. Because to experience the freedom in Christ that sets us free and gives us a new nature. But here's the thing. If you're listening to this so far, you're thinking, man, boy, you're coming down heavy on this stuff. Well, here's the third thing. Homosexuality is a sin. But listen, it is a sin that can be forgiven. It is a sin that can be forgiven. Paul spells it out in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. He said, do you not know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? And then he goes on and he lists. And it's interesting because you got to understand, there are some people that, all they pick on is homosexuality. But if you go to that chapter, okay, if you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11, he doesn't just talk about, it's one among many. He talks about fornicators. He talks about liars. He talks about adulterers. He talks about cheats. He talks about disobedient. He's naming names. He said, do you not know that these people will not inherit the kingdom of God? That means they're not going to heaven. But then Paul doesn't stop there. Those who persist in those lifestyles will end up going to hell. You can't be a practicing homosexual and go to heaven. You can sing Amazing Grace a million times, but if you're practicing, you cannot. That's what the Bible says. But here's the thing, they don't have to end up that way. Because here's what Paul said, such were some of you. That's a powerful statement right there. Meaning, in our context today, some were homosexuals. They were homosexuals. The tense of the verb is very crucial. Were and are. It's different. The entire difference between heaven and hell is found in the difference between were and are. What happened to them? What happened to them? They were washed in the blood of Jesus. Amen? They were justified by the grace of God. They were sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Think about that. Every one of us. We once were lost, but now we're found. We were, but we are. I was a sinner. I was a reprobate. That's what I was, but I am a child of God. I am now saved and blood bought, washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, looking forward to the coming of Jesus Christ, the blessed hope of the church. That's what Paul said. You were like this. You were in your sin. You were homosexuals, but you have been changed, washed in the blood of Jesus, justified through God, and sanctified by the Holy Spirit. See, that's what the gospel, that's the message that we have. Our message is not to get up here and lament or beat people over the head with how nasty and how rude and how sinful they are. That's not the gospel. The gospel is, yes, you are a sinner, but you can be a child of God. You can be set free from that. See, that's what the gospel can do. It can take a man or a woman who is mired in homosexuality. It can forgive them, change them, redirect their lives, give them a new heart, a new mind, and a new destiny. And that's the message the church needs to proclaim. That's the hope. It's not more laws. It's not new elected officials. It's the gospel that reaches into the sinful heart of man. Every one of us needed that one day where we found ourselves a sinner, knowing that we needed a Savior, and He reached down into the darkness of our soul, and He arrested us, and He rescued us, and He gave us a new nature, and He put us on the right path. Listen, He can do that for anybody. I want you to stand with me as I close. Here's what happens, though, and my prayer is that God help us to see the light and not change, and to change. Because verse 32 gives us the end result of what happens when a society insists on rebellion after rebellion after rebellion. Here's what he says. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only, listen to what he said, they not only continue to do these things, but they approve of those who do them. In other words, when you get to that point, your conscience has been seared with a hot iron. You are no longer able to distinguish between what is right and what is wrong. And God help us, we're moving very, very rapidly. If we're not already there, as a nation, we're moving very, very quickly to that end result. My prayer, listen, I love you with every fiber of my being. I love this body, this church, my family. I would be derelict in my duty if I didn't preach the truth. I would be derelict in my duty. Again, it's not bathed in hate. It's bathed in love. You've got children and you have grandchildren that are growing up in a world that's been perverted. Listen, I believe, you know, where darkness abounds, grace did much more abound. You need to have conversations with your children and your grandchildren. You need to be able to speak the truth. Be anchored in it. Be knowledgeable about what the Bible teaches. Basically, we live in a broken world, and God's creation has been broken. It's been upset, turned upside down. Natural has become unnatural, and that's what we see in society. And our job when we're born again is we set back on His way, not our way. And the only prayer you can pray, listen, if it's in your family, if you have family members that are struggling with this, maybe acquaintances, let me give you this suggestion. The answer is not to sit there and try to beat and break them. That's not the answer. The answer is simply this. Pray that God would open the eyes of their understanding that they might see His truth and be enlightened. Because the Bible says that the things of God are spiritually discerned. If they have no spirit within them, if their spirit's still dead in sin, they can't understand God's truth. So you pray for that loved one by name. God, I'm praying for Sally. I'm praying for John. They're mired in this world. They bought into the lie that they can be fulfilled without you. I'm asking you to open the eyes of their understanding so they can know your truth and be set free. Isn't that what Jesus said? You shall know the truth, and the truth shall do what? Set you free. Won't you bow with me this morning? I know this is a tough message, and how do you do an altar call after a message like this? Listen, there are two things I want to do right now. Number one is this. Maybe you're here today, and I'm going to throw the maybe in there. Maybe you're here today and you struggle with the same-sex attraction. Again, it wouldn't be abnormal because we live in a broken world, and those things happen. But you've heard the truth today. You've heard enough to save you, and you've heard enough to condemn you. It's your choice. So I want to give an opportunity for us to pray with you that God would help you in your struggle. But here's the second part of that. That's still just one. But the second part of that is maybe you have somebody in your family or somebody you love and that's close to you that's struggling with this lifestyle. You say, Pastor, I'm praying for their salvation. I'm praying. I want us to pray with you together. So I want to ask you in a moment to come down and stand in their stead as we pray with you for them. And the second thing is this, if you're here today and you need prayer for anything, maybe you've gone to the doctor this week and you've got a bad report, maybe you've got a financial crisis, maybe there's a relationship thing going on. Listen, I love you, and I want to see God's best for you. So as we sing this morning, would you come? Would you let us pray with you, stand with you in agreement? Listen, the arm of the Lord is not short that He cannot reach, and His ears not deaf that He cannot hear. God wins. Go ahead and sing. As they sing, won't you come? Let us pray.
This is a house of worship. This is a place of praise, where every demon trembles, where we proclaim Your name. This is a house of healing. Our hearts are full of faith. You have our full attention. You have the final say. So come alive. In the name of Jesus, come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles, and we bring everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. This resurrection. Your blood runs through our veins. Your kingdom triumphs over even the coldest grave. Come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles.
I still believe in miracles. I still believe that God's arm is not short, that He can't reach. I know these are going to continue praying this morning. We have backpacks and stuff to give away, but listen, my prayer is that you've received this message in the heart in which it was given. Not one of hate, not one of anger, one of obedience to God. But here's the thing, church, we have a lot of work to do. We have a lot of work to do. Shine Jesus wherever you go. We live in a broken, fallen world. People are struggling with all kinds of brokenness that manifests in many different ways. Our job is not to judge and condemn. Our job is to speak truth and shine His light that brings change. Father, I love You today and I thank You so much. I thank You for Your truth that sets men free. Lord, this is a message that, Lord, the enemy doesn't want to hear, want people to hear, because there's freedom in this message. Lord, I pray for our loved ones here today that have family, friends, extended family, friends that are struggling with this type of brokenness. We pray that the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened so that they can find Your truth and live Your truth. I ask You to go with us today. May we walk out firmly anchored in the truth of who You are. And Father, I pray for the families that receive backpacks today. Lord, those children, as they go off to school, protect their hearts and their minds. Let them flourish, Lord, in their academics, and let them shine brightly with the radiance of Christ. Give us this great week, Lord. Put people in our pathway that we can share the good news of Jesus Christ. Thank You for all that You do. We love You. In Jesus' name, we all said, Amen. Thank you for being with us online. I look forward to seeing you next time. God bless you, and I love you very much.
Come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. We bring everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is Jesus, this is a house of miracles.